in Scranton on November 29, 1965, Jeffrey J. Walsh grew up in an Irish Catholic home deeply rooted in its Catholic faith. Actively involved in his parish at St. Vincent de Paul, he never really thought about the priesthood growing up. As a teenager attending Scranton Central High School, he actually thought of becoming a truck driver. It wasn't until he attended a retreat during his junior year at the University of Scranton that Jeff started seriously considering the possibility of entering the seminary.
The first time that the seed for the specific seed planted for the vocation to the priesthood was with Father Joe Simmons, a Jesuit priest at the University of Scranton. And when I was on a retreat called Search, it was the first time I was really delving that deeply into faith at a more mature level. I guess, I'm 20 years old, and you learn your catechism and you know what church is at a certain level as a child, but I found myself at a place where I wanted to learn more, and I saw my peers interacting with faith at a deeper level. And I guess at the end of that retreat, it was only a weekend retreat, but Father Simmons must have noticed something in me, searching for that deeper faith. And he said, "Did you ever think about being a priest?" And of course, at that time I hadn't. It really never even in any serious way crossed my mind. And he just said, "Think about it." And then in God's providence later on, when I went in the seminary, he became my spiritual director, and then even as a priest. And he died shortly after I was ordained a priest in 1994. But I always looked to him as an inspirational person who really was the first to plant the seed.
To this day, Father Jeff credits his parents and grandparents for providing the foundation that would eventually lead to his priestly vocation.
Hello, Jeff. Hello. How are you?
How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good.
How's it going there, fella?
How are you?
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
I just, had a neighborhood where there was lots of, friends, and, I had the freedom to go out and, just do a lot of the stuff that kids do. And, had a family that was always at home and supportive and gave good example. And, I understood the proper place that the church played in our lives, going to Mass every Sunday, going to CCD, and during the weekday, serving as an altar boy. And then just trying to be a good person, knowing that my parents and grandparents were good role models. They were involved in civic organizations, and they worked hard, and they had discipline in the home, which isn't always the favorite thing for kids, as we know. That's just part and parcel of it. So I gave them the share of our hard times and, testing the boundaries of discipline over the years, the typical teenage things. But they were always there. They were just always supportive, whether it was playing a game of basketball and there they are in the stands, on a Friday night when no one else is around. You're just, looking up and seeing them, and that they're there because they love you and support you. So millions of examples like that I would attribute to my parents and my grandparents. I was already graduated from college, and I would say three things came together in an unexpected way. One, I was not really happy with the job that I was in, and I couldn't see myself doing it for the long term. And second, I had been in a relationship during college which had ended, and I was not attached, so I wasn't in a dating relationship. And then thirdly, I always use the excuse in my head that I don't really know what a priest does other than say Mass. So my grandmother died unexpectedly, and a young priest had come to visit her in the hospital. And when I saw what he did there, that fleshed out for me what a priest does other than say Mass. He brings comfort and peace and prays with people, and brought a great sense of relief during that very difficult time when my grandmother was in the hospital. And then he was there as a follow-up. So I guess all three of those things at once, as I started praying about it and thinking, what is God saying to me through these things, the option of entering into the seminary became one of those realities. And I approached that priest, Monsignor Delaney, what I would need to do if I were to take the next step. So he showed me, took me into the car, went up to St. Pius Seminary, and showed me around. He said, this is where you would go, and explained to me what the process would be like to apply. And I just remember thinking, if I'm going to do this, I need to be able to at least run it by those people who are closest to me. So ran it past my parents, obviously, first, and then my siblings, and then my best friends. And all of them were very supportive. And it didn't shock them the way I thought it might shock them. But they said, we will support you. And if that's what you want to do, good for you. Go for it. And so I just put my best foot forward. And one thing leads to another once you get accepted. And that's how it all came about.
Following his formation at Mount St. Mary's Seminary in Emmitsburg, Maryland, Father Jeff was ordained as a priest for the Diocese of Scranton by Bishop James C. Timlin at the Cathedral of St. Peter on June 25th, 1994.
My vision for what I felt God was calling me to was kind of the front lines of what priesthood is. The diocesan priest who is in a parish, who is, you know, there for everything from the cradle to the grave in dealing with families and dealing with people. That's what always excited me about the diocesan priesthood, was to have that opportunity just to be in the ordinary experiences of life, but the extraordinary gift of faith that can help people through everything that's in life, through the encounters in the church with the sacraments and with community building experiences that the church seems to always provide. I mean, growing up in Scranton, you're at a different parish picnic every weekend, you know, and you see just the vibrancy of parish life through a lot of different angles. And to me, that's what I thought was neat, you know, to see the parish priests walking around at the parish picnic, or, you know, at whatever fundraiser there might be, or seeing them walking the halls of a hospital, visiting the sick, or whatever the case is. To me, that was what I wanted to do.
In July of 1994, Father Jeff headed out to Carbondale to take on his first assignment as assistant pastor of St. Rose of Lima Parish.
Well, I was very happy to get him as my assistant because, first of all, I knew his family long before he came with me. As a young priest, there are a few things that really stood out. I would say the biggest thing that stood out was the fact that he was very energized by serving people. And he loved to go to visit the hospitals. He loved to go and do communion calls to visit the sick. Anytime there was any kind of social need with the poor or the needy, he was right on deck to help. And I think his special charism was that he had a great way of communicating with young people. So he was very active in youth ministry so that I could really feel that no matter what I asked him to do, he was happy and excited and enthusiastic about doing it. He loved being a priest.
Tonight, at this solemn vigil mass of the Lord's resurrection, we, like Peter in the gospel just heard, should be full of amazement. All throughout this mass, our senses will be bombarded with the sights and the sounds and the tastes and the smells of the Easter proclamation. If you're like me, you would agree that it would be worthy just to come to this Mass to hear that wonderful Gloria that we just heard, the proclamation of Jesus is alive. But look around. the beauty of the spring flowers. This faith of ours is truly amazing. We worship a God who became man, a man who performed miracles, yet was crucified as a criminal, a man who rose from the dead, yet 3 days after promised to be with his church until the end of time, a poor man who lived in a tiny part of the world 2,000 years ago, but somehow draws you and me together to himself in an intimate relationship right here and now. Jesus was and is the way, the truth, and the life.
After 2 years of service at St. Rose of Lima, Father Walsh returned to Scranton to assume his new role as assistant pastor here at the Cathedral of St. Peter. Father had no sooner arrived when then rector, Monsignor Joseph Quinn, invited Father Walsh to join his brother priest in the parish's annual fundraiser, Cathedral Capers.
Amazingly so. When you just referenced the fundraiser locally and the tower of the bank that he scaled coming down from the top floors, I used to refer that as a leap of faith, and it really was. Capers, on the other hand, was a leap of joy. And lots of fun over the years. We went through that for 20 years. John Cosgrove, the long-term MC, used to say that it was his longest penance ever to have served as 10 years as MC. But Father Walsh was typical of the many priests over the years who involved themselves in that fundraiser for the cathedral, where we would put a dozen or 15 priests on stage and have live music behind them. And people were astounded that they would do what they did, sing, dance, tell stories, do magic acts, all to help the cathedral. And Father Walsh was a stellar example of that. When I think back to the things he did, and most of them were his own creative thoughts, but if he was asked to do anything above and beyond that, absolutely, no, always open to a new idea.
We really did have a conversation just the other day about what it might have been like if we just had the opportunity to dream a little bit. We have a great awareness of all of the things that people do in our community. And, you know, we weren't just hatched as priests, you know. We had dreams and ambitions of our own at one time prior to going into the priesthood. And as we sat around, we discussed this. It was a very odd coincidence that there just happened to be a camera there when we were having this conversation. Cue it up, boys.
My mother and father made me go to college. I wanted nothing to do with college. The thing I wanted to do was be a truck driver. You better believe it.
Kidding. Oh, truck driver.
You're not kidding, Father Walsh.
When I kid you guys, you're priests.
I would love to have been a truck driver. My favorite show on earth was BJ and the Bear. And I looked at that guy every day, and he was out on the open road, and he had independence, and he was living life with gusto. That's what I wanted to be, a truck driver.
Big 18-wheeler. Imagine that.
Only it was possible.
Sure is a beautiful day to be out trucking. Boy, to think that I could have been spending all my days cooped up in a rectory somewhere. Life on the road, it ain't easy. It sure has its rewards. Got the open road. Lots of good eating at the truck stops. Meet all kinds of good folks on the road. Paycheck ain't that bad. Don't get to church every Sunday, but try to get there when I can.
In the years that followed, Father Jeff managed to combine his love for the outdoors with fundraising efforts at the various parishes he served, including St. Mary of the Lake Parish in Lake Winola.
I've actually, at this point, I've done a fundraising triathlon. And that was kind of a goal that just evolved over time. I started with running the Steamtown Marathon. I forget what year it was, maybe 1999. And I was at St. Mary of the Lake at Lake Winola, and we needed a new rug. So I thought maybe I could get people to sponsor me by the mile and then run the race and see what happens, and whatever funds can be raised, we'll get a new rug. So we call it Run for the Rug. And that began fundraising using an opportunity to do some physical exercise, which I've always enjoyed. Then the next one, when I was down in Tonkanic and they needed new windows in the building and Father Nallen Center. So we dreamed up an idea. I was biking a lot at the time, and I got my road bike and a friend of mine, Ed Coleman, and said, we'll do some fundraising starting at my alma mater, Mount St. Mary's in Emmitsburg, Maryland, and we'll bike back up to Tonkanic. And just have people sponsor us by the mile. And I forget how many miles it was. It took us a day and a half or something like that. And we call that Windows to the Soul, meaning S-O-L-E, windows from Father Nallen to the sole of our feet, pedaling those bikes. So we raised a whole bunch of money and got new windows for Father Nallen Center. And then a third opportunity came up, and we called it Swim for the Inn. We needed a new inn, a new entranceway to the church. And if we first thought of it as a canopy or just a way to keep people out of the rain as they're entering into the church. But then a vision developed to make it kind of a narthex or a way, something that could be more substantial and you could do more with it, but we'd need to raise more money. So we thought of doing the swim for the inn. So I swam the 4 mile perimeter of Lake Winola. And again, people were out on their docks and, cheering me on, and they had fundraising for it, I forget what formula we use. It wasn't by the mile, but it was contribute to the swim for the inn, and it's going to go to a good cause. So people were very supportive of those efforts, and I just found it to be a way to heighten interest in something and then, use it for a good purpose.
Father Jeff's most recent fundraising effort was a walk with his faithful companion Sam to raise money for the restoration of the steeple at St. Rose of Lima Church in Carbondale.
Lord, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for the work that is being done on this incredible tower, this beacon of hope and promise and love and God's mercy to this entire community. And finally, Lord, we just ask your blessing upon this community and this congregation, that it will always be a community filled with love, hope, working towards peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
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 Thank you, all of you, who all of you in so many and different ways have worked to make this a reality. Thanks.
Amen.
Thanks.
Beautiful.
I'm actually proud of you.
Yeah. Fantastic. We're lucky. Beautiful prayer.
Very lucky.
I think, even the bishop coming today to offer a blessing, it means really a renewed sense of pride, a renewed sense of commitment, and I think a joy in the Catholic faith. I mean, again, from my understanding, a steeple on a church represents how within the community it points us to heaven. It reminds us. Every time you look at a steeple, it's to remind you to point to heaven. And that's where our orientation and faith should always be. And I think that there's something important about that. And to me, like a day like today, when the bishop being here and offering the blessing on the workers and giving thanks for all the efforts that over the course of over this last year, a year and a half, have been to raise the money and to get the coordination of all these people to do what we can do, that it's a renewal of faith, basically. It is an awesome restoration of this beautiful building that means a lot. It's the oldest church in Lackawanna County and one of the earliest churches in the Diocese of Scranton. So we know that it was built on the backs of coal miners and people, the immigrants who came to this area, who took their faith seriously. And it's good to know that new generations are still doing that.
Over his 27 years of priestly service here in the Diocese of Scranton, Father Jeff had a particular love for youth ministry, dating back to his days as a seminarian, helping out with Project Hope at Camp St. Andrew.
I think it's so important because they don't have an opportunity offered to them like this anywhere else. And I worked with Project Hope in 1986, and I have a firsthand experience of what it's like to be with the kids for the whole day, for their program. And there is such a need for the kids to have an experience like this because they look forward to swimming, they look forward to getting out of the city, wherever they may be, for whatever circumstance they find themselves in.
Just working with young people has been a great joy, and I found that through Camp St. Andrew, when I first started there, just the energy and the excitement, and it was natural. to work with kids, and you know, I enjoy it very much, even within the frustrations and the different problems that might come up. But there's something special about it, and I'm glad that I'm still young enough to kind of keep up with them, because I really just enjoy being involved with whatever they have to do. I find it very authentic and genuine to work with young people, and their witness to faith gives me inspiration to move on and to continue my own faith development, because I really find that they give me something, which I'm very grateful for.
I think it was a great opportunity for me. I looked at those experiences of being with young people as a way to try to, first of all, draw them into something of a kind of faith that I saw myself lacking and then finding, and I wanted to be a part of them finding it perhaps too, because I just thought it was exciting, you know, to experience that. And I just wanted to, in whatever way I could, maybe be a good example and maybe inspire something of a faith along their faith journey for young people. But also because I just drew energy and strength and joy and love from being around young people too. I love that opportunity from my end of formation, needing to always kind of keep a finger on the pulse of what are their favorite songs or what are their interests, and not wanting to become a fuddy-duddy, an old person who's just stuck in their ways, you know, like to find out what brings them joy and what brings them excitement and what is their vision. And to hear that and then to just kind of be with them in it. So that's why I've loved those opportunities to be in schools or on mission trips. I've done over, I think, 20 mission trips altogether. And each summer, I would try to carve out that time because either through the Pontifical Mission Society or I've done some with Scranton Prep, and I've done some mission trips with Holy Cross School, that they always had juniors going into their senior year, which is a great opportunity, a pivotal moment in their lives where they're discerning like what colleges to go to or what they want to do with their life. You know, they're kind of at that stage where it's really, you know, they're not a kid, but and they're trying to discover who they really are, where God is calling them. And I just really enjoyed that time on a mission because it stretched them. It gave them an opportunity to be challenged and to discover something new about themselves by service and by the celebration of the sacraments. So I loved, you know, the opportunity to be there with them for Mass, confessions, adoration, night prayer, morning prayer, faith sharing, and then be out, you know, playing basketball with them or doing a work project, being in a ditch, you know, digging something or building something with the Habitat for Humanity project or whatever the case was. So I just think, and I still, I hope till the day I die, I enjoy the company of young people just because of the mutual benefit I think it has.
Of all the friendships that Father Jeff has made over the years, no one friend has been more loyal than his beloved dog, Sam.
It was September 11th, 2010, when I was looking for a dog and I found a rescue organization that was bringing puppies up from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, from a rescue there, a kill shelter. And it was a match made in heaven. I found Sam, took him home, and he was named Sam because it was an anniversary of 9/11, and I wanted to think of something patriotic to call him. So I thought of Uncle Sam, and that's how he got the name Sam. And it's just been an amazing part of my life ever since. I love what a dog does for the dynamics of a parish. Right off the bat, you know, everybody asks you, how's your dog? And I was able to take him to the parish and people love petting him and, you know, getting to know him. And that's how it's been. He's been through three transitions with me and he's about to enter a fourth transition. But all throughout the years, he's been, when I say match made in heaven, because I love being out in the woods and just being active, and he's been right by my side for a vast majority of any time I've been outside. And I could leave him off the leash and he doesn't, I can't shake him. Like he wouldn't run away. He knows where his bread is buttered. So I think he knows not to ever stray too far, but he always will just go. And you know, any place I go for long hikes or when I used to run, he'd run right alongside with me for 10 miles and, you know, not think anything of it. Jump in the car and ready to go again. So And he's been a tremendous comfort. And I could just share this with you, that when I received the phone call from Archbishop Pierre about this new change in my life, I couldn't tell anybody for several days. But I told Sam. So Sam was my great comfort for those days when my mind was reeling over all the changes and responsibilities that were coming. And I just didn't have any other outlet than to sit with Sam and just let him know. And I think he sensed it. You know how they, and I know you're a dog lover, and you know, dogs sense that there's something off or something different, or if you're not feeling well. And I think he has had that instinct during that whole week. And anyway, that's one example of many where, you know, I always tell people that I can read his mind, he can read my mind, and we look alike.
On December 13th, 2021, Father Jeff was out celebrating his dad's birthday when he received a phone call that would forever change his life.
It was December 13th. I'll never forget it because it's my dad's birthday. And my mom and dad had just come from St. Anne's Novena, where they always go. I think it was a Monday. And my godmother was there too, very unexpectedly, that I don't have many opportunities to see her. And she's 90 years old, but she's my dad's sister. So her and my cousin Mike were there, my mom and dad, at Alfredo's Pizza, famous from The Office. And we were just sitting there enjoying a meal, and my phone buzzed in my pocket. I took it out and I saw it was from Washington, D.C. I thought it was a robocall, put it back in my pocket. I said, I don't know anybody in Washington. So finished the meal and went outside and looked at my phone, and that Washington number had left me a voicemail. And I still have it, and I'm going to keep it probably forever. This is Archbishop Christophe Pierre. I'm calling a when you have an opportunity, please call me back. I'd like to have a conversation with you. So, you know, he doesn't call just to see how the weather is in Scranton. But I knew something serious and important was awaiting. So I got in the car, and my mind was going a million miles a minute. And I found a place, an overlook in Carbondale off the KC Highway. I figured I could call him there. At least I'll have peace of mind and a clear mind. And I call him, and of course he wasn't there, and I had to leave him a voicemail. And 10 minutes later, as I'm pulling into the parking lot at St. Rose, he calls, and I'm looking at the statue of the Blessed Mother in the parking lot as I'm on the phone with Archbishop Pierre. And after some pleasantries, he's a wonderful man, and he was asking about my family and how my mom and dad are doing, and what it's like at the parish assignment where I'm at here at St. Rose and Our Lady of Mount Carmel. And then, I mean, I knew something was coming eventually. And he said that Pope Francis has appointed you Bishop of Gaylord. And he probably heard an audible gasp, and my mind went numb. And then he said, so you know where Gaylord is? And I said, Archbishop, I'm so sorry. And I was stumbling for words. I said, Archbishop, I don't think so. Is it in Texas? And he said, he bust out laughing, and then he said, no, it's in Michigan. And then he explained, you know, what the diocese was and the history, a little bit of it. And then a couple other pleasantries and some directives, and that was it. And he said, Bishop Bambera had been notified, and you can contact him, but nobody else.
When some of us were young people, there was a tradition at home that we'd get many gifts for Christmas, but you could always choose one of the gifts to open early. And what I'm suggesting today is that the Diocese of Gaylord has received an early Christmas gift in the presence of our newly appointed bishop, who I'm so happy to be able to welcome today as we look forward to his coming and to his formal installation on Friday, March 4th. I received a call from the Apostolic Nuncio in 2019, about 18 months ago, asking if I would come to Gaylord for some months. And I have been here for 18, and I guess that is some months. But it's been a wonderful experience to be here. And then last Monday, I received a call from him telling me, well, we have a new bishop to appoint for the Diocese of Gaylord. And he said, his name is Father Jeffrey Walsh. I said, who? Never heard of him before, you know? And then I spoke to Bishop-elect Walsh on the telephone, and he said when the nuncio called him, he said, the Holy Father is appointing you to be the bishop of the Diocese of Gaylord. And the nuncio said, do you know where that is? And Bishop Walsh answers, well, isn't that in Texas? And so what I'm saying is this, the only way you could describe this situation is, this is a marriage made in heaven because we couldn't come up with it on our own. But it's a special joy to welcome him today as well.
On December 21st, a press conference was held at St. Mary Cathedral in Gaylord, Michigan, to announce that Pope Francis had appointed Father Walsh as the sixth bishop of the Diocese of Gaylord.
I feel amazed still. I understand it as something that is necessary for my salvation, that God must see it as a way that I need to follow in order to get to heaven. But I also see it as a great challenge, and I could easily get overwhelmed by what the sense of responsibility is, because I've seen it somewhat up close, having served as vicar for clergy and as a regional vicar, and just knowing what our bishops all around the world have gone through, you know, recently with the scandals and with, you know, the burdens of the office. But I could tell you, I'm very, very blessed. I feel very affirmed and overwhelmed in terms of the gracious, you know, affirmations that have come from people, friends and family, and I feel, you know, just if I can carry the torch in whatever way, you know, for the Diocese of Scranton, as a priest of the Diocese of Scranton, proud of that and proud of my family that I've come from and want to do them honor.
I try to get this out of my system. I'll shed a tear or two here, but let me just thank my parents who gratefully can watch through CTV back home instead of fumbling around trying to find it on the internet. But thank my mom and dad. They're the most important people in my life. They've been married almost 60 years. And just couldn't ask for better parents.
Excited every day.
Well, I never thought he'd become a bishop. But I'm, like I said, I was very happy to be the mother of a priest. And, you know, years ago, to have a priest in the family was such an honor, you know what I mean? And I think it was almost inbred in me growing up because of my father's association and my mother and, you know, with the church and priests. And I don't know, I think maybe like the fact that I said that when the third boy was born, maybe deep down I knew that someday maybe one of them would be a priest, you know. But whatever. I mean, it's been a wonderful life, I think, if it's meant for you. It's a wonderful life, and it's the things you get to do, I mean, he's had experiences that he would have never, ever had, you know.
Our oldest son, I thought, might enter the priesthood. I never really thought of Joe or Jeff entering the priesthood until he really told us that night. And, you know, the more you think about it, it's almost God's will. And there's, you know, when you look back, it's, that's it. And he turned out, that's what it was, God's will. It's funny because when Jeff was in high school, I think all he wanted to do was drive a tractor trailer. And, you know, I told him, you can't drive until you're 21. And he had to go to school. He didn't really want to go to college. And we sort of talked him into it. And now all of a sudden, he's not only got college, he's got, you know, all the master's degrees and everything else, but he's got a lot of schooling behind him. But as far as being a priest, I think that was set in stone at one point of the game. I think he understands people more than a regular person. I think he can get in with people and almost feel what they're feeling. And, you know, he's sincere. He's a very sincere man. And he's always like that. And he's interested in you. And I think it shows. I think it really shows. But I think he's really got his calling. And that's very important in life, that you like what you're doing. And he likes what he's doing.
Father Walsh, I know throughout the course of his tenure as a priest in our diocese, has always been open to whatever assignment was proposed to him by me, by Bishop Martino, by Bishop Timlin. And what really struck me was that after I had asked Father Walsh to serve as vicar for clergy, which he did for 5 years, and it was a five-year term that was associated with it, when those 5 years were completed, he said to me, I'm honored to have done this work. I need to go back into a parish. I need to be a pastor again. And to me, that's the greatest gift that any priest or any bishop can have, that desire to want to be with their people, to get to know a community, to serve it, and to be a part of its life.
As Bishop-elect Walsh starts this new chapter in his life as Bishop of Gaylord, family, friends, parishioners, and brother priests all agree that he is more than ready to take on this new assignment.
I think he's probably very prepared. I think the last few jobs he had really probably helped out an awful lot. You know what I mean? Yeah, he seems like he handles. I was always amazed at, you know, no matter where he was assigned, how he kind of fit right in. And we've had a wonderful 27 years of his priesthood, I'll tell you. We've been to every parish, loved going to his masses, met wonderful people, you know, different parishioners from every parish, going to the fundraisers, the dinners, all the stuff that goes along with it. We've really had a wonderful 27 years.
I think he's seen and done just about everything that a priest can do. I think he's done the priestly thing. I think he's got with the administration. I think he's dealing with his own kind, the priest, and with the public. I think he's been overseas. He's been almost every state in the union. And, you know, he's just been around all over, and he enjoys that. He really enjoys meeting people. That's the way he is, and that's the way, you know, he just likes people.
Father Walsh has been such a great friend, number one, great mentor, great priest, and I had the opportunity to work with him in the chancery for 5 years. I served as the vicar general, he served as the vicar for clergy, but he's a very gifted man, very gifted priest. And I would say there's a quality of holiness that is really, really significant in his life, and that permeates when he has conversations with people. You kind of see the specialness that he has just because of his authenticness in the way in which he presents himself, the way he celebrates Mass, his daily interactions with people. He's really a good guy. He's really the Diocese of Gaylord is getting a fantastic bishop just because of his priestly zeal and holiness. If you look at his history of assignments, there's a wonderful variety of ministries that he's been able to partake in. And I think it's almost like the Holy Spirit knew what the Holy Spirit was doing, because based on his experience from seminary experience, where he was a spiritual director working on the faculty at St. Pius X, his great love for missionary work, like you indicated, I mean, he's been on several missionary trips. The youth, I mean, he's been on several World Youth Day. He worked in a high school as a religious ed formation director, teaching theology in high school. And then his role in parish ministry, assistant pastor and pastor, and the great gifts and talents that he brought to a parish community. So I think, given his experience, I think he's going to serve the Diocese of Gaylord extremely well, because he has a variety of experience. He's not just coming with a very myopic ministry, he's coming with really a broad experience where he's going to be able to facilitate a lot of different things in that diocese that a bishop is responsible for.
I think Father Walsh, Bishop-elect Walsh, is perfectly poised to assume the responsibilities and the role and the pastoral leadership associated with a bishop. He has had virtually every job in this diocese but mine. And he has served well and generously from being a pastor, certainly starting out as an assistant pastor, to working as vocation director, to being on our seminary faculty, to serving as a regional vicar for Bishop Martino, to serving as vicar for clergy in my administration, to serving on a host of boards and securing several different degrees, advanced degrees, one in spiritual direction, one a master's in social work. He's extremely competent and very, very well positioned to serve the Diocese of Gaylord as generously as he served us.
Father Walsh is truly a servant leader. He understands that to serve is to lead, and to lead is to serve, and he will do it well. And he will do it with great humility, but he puts everything in a positive light. I'm still smiling at his recent letter in his own parish bulletin at St. Rose, where he said there were three things he was looking forward to as he heads out to Michigan. One, to meeting a moose. Two, to seeing the night lights at the Great Lakes. And three, to driving a snowmobile. Now, who else could put it in that context? But he's smiling throughout it all, and bravely, selflessly, courageously going forward as a leader needed in today's church.
He's been in the priesthood since he's a young man. And I lived across the street from the rectory then, and my own boys got to be friendly with Father Walsh, and I thought it was good inspiration for them to stay close to the church, and also to see that there was a possibility that one of them might even have a vocation. As it turned out, they didn't, but we still enjoyed having Father Walsh as our neighbor.
I think he's humble. I think when you see him, you don't really see a priest, a bishop-elect. He seems to be like one of us, and he lives out the gospel every day.
Do you think he's ready to take on this new challenge as a bishop?
Well, he took on Carbondale, didn't he? I think he is. I really do, and our prayers will definitely go with him, and I think he's ready.
It was a great honor to know him as close as we've gotten over the year and a half that he's here, or better, that he's such a humble person, you know, and down to earth, and that's what impressed me about him. And you know, I'll always remember that I'm so lucky to have known someone who's going to become a bishop, our pastor.
Well, I think we have mixed feelings. Certainly we're proud of the fact that he has been chosen, but we're sorry to see him leave here, leave Carbondale, leave St. Rose and Mount Carmel, because he has not been here that long, and we have appreciated the gifts that he's brought. So I think it's a mixed feeling. I think he has a very gentle manner. I appreciate his homilies. He takes the scripture, but he presents it in a way that is very simple, very clear, something that people can have a good thought to take away.
I don't know, from the time he became a priest, and that he used to be here at St. Rose at one time, you know, teaching the school down there, and he did a fantastic job with the kids and like that. He's just a motivator and full of energy.
How do you think he's going to do as a bishop now when he goes out to Michigan?
Oh, fantastic. I'm sure they're going to enjoy him out there, and he's going to do a wonderful job and bring people together, and that's what's important today in this church, is bringing people together.
I've known Father since he was first assigned here at St. Rose, and we've been pretty close throughout the years. But, you know, it's like you have a secret that's really, you know, could change a lot of lives. Would you want to hold it back? And I don't think so. I think he's a great priest, a man, and I think he'll do well. I really do. So to be torn now, right now I realize what a gift he'd be to everybody else.
I got to see something different in him.
I really did. I saw the Holy Spirit. So, what's the word I want to use? Just ingrained in him, you know? And I was talking to him before I came in. He was on the step, and I said, go out and be another St. Paul and spread the good news of our Lord and Jesus and our Savior.
And do you think he's ready to do that now in his new appointment as bishop?
Very definitely. And I think he's going to make a difference in our church. He's got the gift from God to go out and spread that Holy Spirit. You know, our church is in some conflict right now. And I think God chose him for a reason.
And he does have those special gifts and talents?
Yes, he does. Yes, he does. He's an all-compassing. I mean, you know, he's good with the young people. He's good on this altar to make people realize what that gospel is all about. And I think we're missing that.
As he prepares for his Episcopal ordination and installation as Bishop of Gaylord on March 4th at St. Mary Cathedral, Bishop-elect Walsh is inspired by the story of Father Walter Chiswick.
So I do everything I can to promote his cause for canonization, and hoping with Pope Francis being a Jesuit himself that could be part of the grace that is moving his cause along, as well as so many people who have been so adamant and so convicted about his already being a saint. We just hope he could be raised up for the Universal Church's admiration for his heroic virtue. I mean, his story is so compelling. Anybody who picks up the book With God in Russia, you can't put it down. And you find yourself wondering, how could anyone have ever survived the physical aspect of this, let alone the spiritual? And it's just a tremendous source of strength that comes not from him, which is the neat thing about his story, is that he was as tough as nails, and he'd be the first one to say that he did everything in terms of discipline to make himself tough, to endure what might come his way. But like St. Paul in his conversion today, it's when I'm weak is when I'm strong. So he had to be broken, even of his own will, in order to discover the true humility that comes where God can help a person flourish in the true sense of virtue and what can be accomplished for his kingdom. So I think that has always been this inspiration about my attraction to Father Walter, just how he, by the grace of God, got through 24 years behind the Iron Curtain and then came back with no animosity, no hostility, no bitterness. And for another 20 years after he was here, you know, form relationships and spiritual direction and through correspondence. And there's another great book about it, you know, With God in America, that fleshes a lot of his time out when he was here, living at Fordham and going around the country, giving retreats and talks. And it just solidifies his saintly qualities.
When he is officially installed as Gaylord's new bishop, his brother priest here in the Diocese of Scranton offer the same simple words of advice.
For all of the advice that I would give to Father Walsh and that I will share with you is it was simply to be yourself, to be the person that has made you such an exemplary priest in our diocese. You know, the things that stand out to me about Father Walsh and that I think will serve him well in this role in the church, as I spoke a moment ago, is his desire to serve as a pastor. He continues to be a pastor as a bishop, albeit of a larger congregation. His humility, the authenticity of his faith, he's the real deal. I've lived with him here in the cathedral rectory. I know how important his prayer life is to him, the need for spiritual direction, the simplicity of his life. His day off usually found him going up to his parents and in the wintertime shoveling snow and in the summertime cutting grass. And some of his happiest times, I think, in addition to being with Sam, his dog, were to being with his family, his parents, his two brothers and their family, going for a pizza, just enjoying one another's company. He brings very, very down-to-earth pastoral faith-filled qualities that will certainly provide for a wonderful opportunity for him to lead that local church.
My words of advice would be to be yourself. because you have all the qualities needed to be a successful bishop. You're a blessing for the church, and I'm sure everybody in northeastern Pennsylvania is very proud of you, and our prayers go with you. And don't be a stranger. When you come back, let us see you, and let us know how you're doing.
Be who you are. That's the advice that I would give him. Because who he is why the church has called him to be a bishop. And he was here last week. He came for a visit last Thursday evening. And we got to spend some time together chit-chatting and catching up and you know, sharing the excitement that he has and I have for him. But you know what? I think his authentic way of life as a priest, his prayerfulness, his holiness, and I don't say that in a very, I don't really typically say people are holy because we're all a work in progress, but I would characterize him as being a holy priest that I'm privileged to know, and that friendship will continue over the years as we move forward in life. There's going to be a separation, obviously, but there's nothing FaceTime and phone calls and visits could, you know, mend. So I'm really happy for him, and I'm really thrilled for the people of Gaylord.
I guess simply to say, don't change. Be you. Be the real person that everyone in this diocese has loved with every assignment he's had. Be the humble, honest, human, humorous soul we all know him to be. And he will be equally enlivened and at the service of the church.
For Bishop-elect Walsh, this new assignment is bittersweet. He's excited about taking on his new role as Bishop of Gaylord, but he's also saddened by the thought of leaving behind family and so many good friends here in the Diocese of Scranton.
There's so much that has been a part of my life, and I never thought it would be otherwise. You know, you take things for granted, I guess. And it's just something now that I realize that I'm going to be leaving, it has all the more impact on me when I think that what I'm leaving behind. So obviously family is the first and most important thing I know that I will miss, having those day-to-day connections. And although, you know, phone calls and Zooms and FaceTime can alleviate some of that sadness of being separated by miles. But certainly everything else that has been a part of my life. And I love Northeast Pennsylvania. I just grew up here, know every nook and cranny, have been through every aspect of its natural beauty and all of the other aspects of church life and being in places and meeting people. I've loved every minute of it. I mean, I guess even in the difficult times, and every priest goes through difficult times, I've had my share of difficult experiences to go through. And, you know, some of them leave some scars, but it's something that's a part of life's experience. So I'll take all of that with me in gratitude. But the bittersweetness of it is the sadness of saying goodbye to people that you've really grown to know and love. After a priest leaves every assignment, that's a real heartache. You know, and I know I try to put on a strong face about it, or a disposition that I don't want to come across as cavalier by no means, but it's almost a protection against the real emotional part of leaving somebody that you might have had wonderful, you know, opportunities to be with, whether it's at a baptism, a wedding, a funeral, or a confirmation, or whatever, a sacrament, or just getting to know them in whatever capacity, visiting their house, having been over with them for dinner or out at a baseball game with them or wherever. So there's a lot of those things that will be missed from the specific people. God is going to replace that with a whole new set of experiences and people and places where I'm going. But that's going to take an adjustment. You know, there'll be the sadness of really having being uprooted, you know, and going to a whole new place. What was helpful was the conversation with Bishop Kopasz. I met with him the other day because he had the same experience of being called from the Diocese of Scranton to serve as a bishop in Jackson, Mississippi. So it was good to sit with him and know that he got through it, and he was able to share with me what it was like for him, and I found that to be very helpful as well. But yeah, there's going to be a lot of people that I carry with me in my heart and will always have close in prayer. As a human being, we get our dignity from God, and I cherish that. And whatever gifts and talents God gives me or anybody is, I guess, meant to be put to the service of others. And for me as a priest, I've always seen that as a way to draw people to that communion with Christ and his church. So as I celebrate the sacraments, I try to be reminded of that. And I credit my formation, again, with my family and in the seminary for giving me that disposition or that mindset of what priesthood is. You know, the saying, priests of God, celebrate this Mass as if it's your first Mass, your last Mass, your only Mass. So if you're celebrating the Mass in that way, it hopefully draws people to that encounter with Christ and the amazement that we have of hearing his word spoken and receiving Jesus in the Eucharist and pointing people to him. Again, that's to me what the humility of all of our lives, all of our vocations is ultimately about. And in terms of the call to be a bishop, I can share with you the fear and trembling that took effect right afterwards was deep. And when I was praying with it on the second night of sleeplessness, I picked up the prayer book, the Liturgy of the Hours, and the reflection from Thomas A. Kempis on humility was there. And it was like an answer to prayer. You know, just to stay rooted in that virtue. It's so fundamental. And then also prayer of praying with Saint Joseph and knowing he's the man behind the scenes. God had a very special plan for him, but you know, his humility and the special role that he was given was to simply cooperate with God's grace. And I see that as a model, a very important model. And then what keeps coming to my mind is St. John the Baptist's reflection. He must increase, I must decrease. And I think that in a very practical way has to be a part of what I know I need to experience, because again, I can just as easily as anyone get too filled with myself or think of, you know, my own needs before others. And I think those inspirations and those examples are the basis for what will be for the good of the church with anybody exercising the virtue of humility.